W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of Crow Court by Andy Charman, narrated by Mark Mitchinson. Chapter 1. Concerns for Henry Cuff. Wimborne Minster, Dorset, May 1840. Louisa Chilcott is in the dressmaker's by the corn market, taken up residence there, according to her father. White silk, layered over taffeta, and fringed with so many yards of lace that her mother winces each time the dressmaker stretches her arms. Louisa, standing on a stool for access to her hems, has to press her skirts flat to see what is happening on the floor.
Harriet, darling sister, if you want to touch the silk, please, please use your gloves.
Sisters, three in number, comprise two bridesmaids-to-be and one dearly beloved who looks likely to stand and tremble with envy. They've already argued the virtues of silk over lace and white over colour, another skirmish in a lengthy war of wills and a barren debate. Louisa has chosen to follow the fashion set by the newly married queen, and the cloth is cut. The thread of the conversation has spooled onto a subtle attack on the inspiration for Louisa's choice. Kings, it is suggested, reign more supremely than queens. Louisa defends her monarch, her sex, and herself.
They don't go into battle anymore anyway, she says. King George didn't fight at Waterloo. Was it King George, Mama?
A nod of confirmation from Mama is interrupted in her sister's rush to dispute.
Well, it doesn't matter now, claims Miriam, next eldest sister, whose envy will turn to drowned ashes. She's married, so the king will take over.
Ah, but you are quite wrong. He is the queen's consort, a mere prince, Albert.
What's a consort?
Like a concubine, but male.
Yes, thank you, Louisa, says her mother, acting umpire for decorum.
If you could be a lift in your foot, ma'am, asks the dressmaker's assistant.
Louisa does so, glancing up at the window in anticipation of the arrival of Samuel Portman, the affancied, proud as a poppy in about the same proportions, riding into town in a pony and trap, chin up, reins held high, large-headed and thin as a wheel. Rounding the long slope that arcs down from Furze Hill past solemn oaks and Celtic hedgerows, a recent acquirer of superfluous but bountiful knowledge about Queen Victoria's wedding dress, he told his father over breakfast, "It was adorned with orange blossom, you know."
"Was it?" came the grumpy answer.
"Indeed it was."
Has acceded to each and every whim of wedding fashion as willingly as any young groom might. Enlightened by the guiding lamp of adoration. Ponies' hooves thump the resounding bricks of Walford Bridge, causing a lift of the head on the parts of both Bill Brown and John Street, who stand knee-deep in the waters of the Allen, in braces and waders and under the employ of the Wimborne Corporation, clearing rushes from the riverbanks with the aim of averting another flood and thereby saving the margins of the Farmers Fire and Life Insurance Company.
"Proper trimming cropper rushes here,"
Bill declared on the first sight, as he has repeated it twice hourly since. Brick walls to the raindrops of intelligence regarding weddings and related articles of clothing. Only very distantly aware of the then Princess Victoria's visit just a few years ago, and neither of them sympathetic to the rumoured excesses surrounding her procession through the wet Dorset villages, would be limited to guessing at the meaning of the word taffeta. Some new brand of cattle feed? The pony draws the trap on, reined in for safety upon the passing the majestic ivy-covered front of Lang's Hotel, for it would not do to scare one of the women crossing the town square from the Town and Country Bank to the grocers on the High Street. Samuel's appearance outside the dressmaker's prompts a flurry of hiding and tidying, declarations pitched high and a hurried shedding of white silk and lace are a prelude to Louise's emergence in today's demure striped dress. She blushes causelessly, and her eyelids flicker as she climbs the trap to join her future husband. He grins and inquires after the cause of her emotions, but she straightens her expression along with her skirts, and directs him toward the serious matter ahead. The trap curls a tight about turn, and steps are retraced, back through the square, down Westborough, until they reach the door of Charles Ellis, Samuel's best man. The subject of many muttered terms of admiration, credited with being the restoration of his family's fortune following the demise of his violent and intemperate father, and held in altogether greater esteem than Matthew Ellis, the choirmaster and his elder half-brother. If asked, Charles would feign ignorance of the current trends in bridal gowns, and might even raise a single withering eyebrow in distaste at the question. It would be an errant lie. A good friend to Samuel and Louisa, he has heard more than enough about Chantilly, tulle, and gauze to have an opinion. Wouldn't admit it, because he considers himself a simple Dorset man along the lines of Bill Brown and John Street. Presently to be found, as so often in his accounts room at the back of the family home, once a coach house on Westborough, scratching away at ledgers, shepherding his pennies, but summoned to the front by Samuel's loud and insistent knocking. A meek appearance around the side of the half-open door, then a broad smile and greater opening.
"Samuel! Louisa! My, what a welcome surprise! Come in, come in!"
An embarrassed ushering through a bare hall into an ill-decorated parlour. Pretensions to simplicity have disappeared now. Charles apologising for the poor surroundings, entreating his guests to be seated and offering a range of refreshments he couldn't possibly supply. Tea is beyond him. The offer is waved aside by Samuel and Louisa in unison. A frowning from the hopeful couple, Charles leaning in, arm pressed on his chair's faded fabric, detecting disquiet but wanting for its cause. "Something's wrong," he asked. "Louisa has concerns for her cousin, Charles." Turning to her female guest,
"Your cousin?"
"Henry. Henry Cuff. You met him once at the fair at Blandford," Louisa says.
"Blonde-haired lad?"
"Yes. Full of life and a delightful smile. At least, that's how he used to be. The most beautiful singing voice. So we asked him to perform a solo at our wedding."
"He broke into tears," Samuel explains, interrupting his betrothed.
"He did," she adds. "But he would not, for all our entreaties, reveal the cause of his distress."
Charles is concentrating on Louisa's words. She frowns with delicate earnestness.
"It seems to be a problem with either the school or the choir, or perhaps the other boys. He attends Mr. Strickland's church school, but rebels against it passionately. Refuses to go in the morning, and once there, he runs away. Same with the choir."
At the second mention of the choir, Charles glances away with something sour to his expression. Louisa continues.
"His father, Uncle Thomas, is not a very soft man. Not harsh, I shouldn't say..."
"No, not harsh," Samuel adds.
"But not soft either. And the more Henry protests, the more my uncle insists. He must attend school and choir, and he's threatened punishment if he runs away again."
Charles leans back in his chair, running his finger over his lip.
"How can I help?"
Louisa and Samuel exchange a glance. Reflections, perhaps, of an earlier conversation.
"We were rather hoping you might talk to Matthew," says Louisa, showing that pretty delicate frown again.
"Talk to my brother," Charles replies, reacting exactly as he might were he asked to consult the King of Siam. "We thought, since your brother is choirmaster and helps in the school, maybe he could offer some opinion. Perhaps he sees events we are unaware of," Samuel says.
"Perhaps,"
Charles mutters.
"Might I inquire whether you considering putting your queries to him directly?"
"We did."
Another glance exchanged. Then Samuel speaks for the couple.
"Your brother is perhaps not the most approachable of men."
"Nor is he indeed. You should understand, it's not that I don't talk to my brother, but he doesn't talk to me. Nor in any civil manner, at least. He is my half-brother, as you know, and while I own to nothing but respect for the dead, I cannot imagine what manner of woman was my father's first wife.
Charles is halted by the future bride's expression. Can you ask at least? She says. He sighs deeply, then commences nodding.
Naturally, Louisa, naturally. And I shall do so.
Thanks flow from the happy couple. Their problem's solved. A look in Charles's eye, prompted by Louisa's resting her hand on her groom's arm. A flickering of his eyelids until his gaze returns to her face. The afternoon has aged. Charles shuffling into the kitchen, dark suit and a cotton shirt hanging from his slender frame. Ruffled hair and tired eyes, the visible results of a day's work, glancing sideways.
Have you seen that scoundrel of a brother of ours? Did I hear him come in last night?
Question directed at Selina Ellis, weighing bags of flour on the kitchen scales. 16 years old, dressed to add another decade, and behaving accordingly. Only surviving daughter of a deceased mother, with consequent concerns already written into her face. Cooking again. Always tidying, washing or cooking. Her reply.
You have ink on your nose.
Charles is provoked into spreading the blot with his thumb. Selina takes charge, wetting a cloth and grasping her brother's face in order to administer her cleansing influence.
Matthew is not a scoundrel. Our brother is a fine soul. He is a man of God and the church.
He's not a priest, Selina. Granted, he has taken residence in the library, but it is not yet clear which god.
Selina, gripping her brother's ear, clenched, frustrated little fist in a vexed scowl.
Charles, I will not hear it, nor will I suffer you to...
Charles surrendering, holding up his palms to calm his sister, who still has his head suspended.
Very well, he is a pure, incorruptible soul.
Thank you.
An example to us all. Yeah. Where is he?
Charles released, shaking his head for want of understanding. Selina swallowing, still looking distressed.
I believe I heard him leave mid-afternoon. He is no doubt attending evensong. You'll surely find him in the library after prayers.
The chained library. Close. Hot air from a coal-burning stove. Gowns hanging like ghosts, bulking out the wall. Rows of ancient leather-bound books chained like knowledge enslaved to their places on the shelves. Charles, surprised at the door's creak, finds a familiar large-faced man inspecting old-bound papers. The look of haughty superiority is there even before Charles is recognized. His half-brother, presuming.
Ah, the wanted one. Wanting something, no doubt. I've been asked to speak to you. Naturally. Were it not for that, you would not sully yourself with my presence. And?
Charles by the door on a stone step, uncertain.
There's a boy in the choir. Cuff by name. Do you know him?
A sigh, carrying with it the weight of the world's sins. Infinite regret.
Sinners and demons all. I hardly think you make mistake a 10-year-old child for a demon. Yes, little feather, but that's because you hardly think. Vanity holds otherwise. Vanity and conceit, nothing else. What is he to you?
Explaining the connection with the unconcealed impatience of an important younger brother. The cousin of Louisa Chilcott, to be married this week, concerned for his welfare. Does he know of him? Henry Cuff.
Henry? The weeper? Yes, I know him. Youngest of the Cuff brothers, brimming with pride. Brimming with distress, perhaps. How did you acquire such a faculty for inducing misery?
A tired, weary, overtaxed, leaning backwards.
It's my duty to reveal the mystery to young minds more accustomed to pampering and indulgences. Some find the threat of eternal damnation distressing.
Charles, arguing the case for innocence, an exchange that started without warmth, growing quickly heated. Old books, leather-wrapped, absorbing the sounds of fraternal confrontation.
echoes of decades of discord, each point and counterpoint raising the pitch. The double-bound tomes imparting nothing. Finally, Charles presents the request. Will Matthew have a care for Henry Cuff?
Have a care for the weeper? Look out for him?
Spoken like a muttered reminder.
I am now to be chasing after snotty, squawking choir boys. Their spiritual welfare matters not. I should be wiping their asses like a nursemaid.
Charles, turning on his heel, stepping from the room and closing the door, his face impassive. Something, pride, defiance, maybe stubbornness, saves the door from a slamming. After his departure, old insults and resentments still echo silently from the Minster's stones. A feather in the air, a fart, the boy whose mother lived, whose father never tried to thrash the petty reminder from his face, all the vanity of men. Still observed by captive words, a large fist pushing silently against a desk, pressing, clenching, turning slowly, resenting, knuckles hard against wood. Sunday morning service. Children, shuffling feet and parents whispering reprimands. Sun through the minster's windows, casting heavenly white beams upon stone. Dust motes floating ecstatic in the divine light. Rev Cooksley, reading the bands with an unenthusiastic tone. He might be listening the minster's fittings.
The third time of asking, if any of you know cause or just impediment.
Louisa glancing sideways at Samuel. His beaming smile. Her blush and flickering eyelids. Several faces turning their direction until the next couple's names come up and attention is redirected. Only her sighing sister's gazes dwindle. A hymn. The church organ moaning out a low and solemn introduction, joined by the choir's bass and then capped by alto voices. Louise's eye traced the line from the organ master to the choir master to the choir. Leaning in towards Samuel, a frown directs his attention. What is Samuel prompted to observe? At first, nothing untoward, to judge from his expression, but then he too tightens his brow as he reads the expression on the faces in the choir stand. Children, for the most part. Unskilled at hiding their emotions, and what they display is easily enough decoded, even from the third row of pews. Anger. Resentment. Hurt. The older boys towards the back. Spite. Resignation. When the hymn singing is done, the Rev Cooksley offers his sermon, preaching the lessons of spring. The lead into the crucifixion. Rebirth must be prepared for. The new life of spring is reliant on shedding of leaves in the autumn. Sacrifice is not easy or enjoyable. Such is its nature. Sacrifice may be considered suffering, and certainly the Lord our Shepherd demonstrated this path. Should we expect rebirth if there's been no prior sacrifice? Can a tree bud without first shedding leaves? The question is put as though recited. Louisa turns towards Samuel. Her earnest frown, prayers, more hymns. The taking of communion conducted under the considered gaze and intellectual smile of the vicar. Final hymns and prayers, and a congregation shuffles towards the church door and blessed fresh air. Louisa, sisters at discreet giggling distance, walking close by her future husband on the path towards Cook Row and the corn market.
I had never before noticed how oppressive it is. Makes me wish we'd chosen St. John's. Poor Henry. He looks utterly miserable.
Solemn, humming noises from Samuel. Agreement and gravity. They meet Charles passing the odd fellows, falling in step and looking attentively between the two of them.
Here's what we shall do, says Charles. We shall go to your uncle and explain. Dr. Firth's classroom is said to be just as good as...
Both Louisa and Samuel shaking their heads.
We have spoken with him at length. He demands an objection of substance. Did you gain anything from Matthew?
Charles's head is bowed as he shakes. Confessional.
Louisa, my brother...
A sigh.
thoughts of his sister's solicitations, the choosing of words.
"My brother, I'm afraid, may yet to be proved to be the source of your cousin's distress. Are you sure we cannot reason with the boy's father?"
The couple concede that it might be possible, but their expressions offer less hope. Charles offers to talk to the schoolmaster, and then, almost as an aside, to inquire of John Street.
"John was never able to tolerate Matthew. Maybe he'll provide me with these reasons."
Louisa suggests that Mr. Cuff might be approached once the additional inquiries have been completed, that they could be offered as further information. A parting completed in agreement and with renewed purpose. Monday morning. John Street, out in Walford Meadows, the town's northern boundary, where the terraced dwellings of Eastborough stop and the hills rise up above the Allen. Knee-deep in reeds when Charles finds him.
"Morning, John."
"Morning, Charlie."
Spoken quietly, deep tone from a large frame, hands white and puffy from the water.
"No bill today?"
Charles asks.
"A digging graves for the vicar, when he's going up Carter's for to fetch the rafts."
"For this?"
pointing at the heap of reeds.
"Cassett leave it there. Cal have it. Send him up skint."
Charles nodding, regarding the pile of wet reeds with new respect. A cheeky smile on John's face.
"You join us for labouring, then?"
Charles shaking his head.
"Need to ask you a question, John."
"Well, you ask away. Asking free."
John always loathed Charles's brother. Never did say why, but refused his company outright. Even the prospect of it turned him away. What was the reason? That's what Charles wants to know. John, staring back at him, smile withered, face dark as a gathering storm, has his reasons, that's all.
"When was it, John? Sunday school? Bible classes?"
A reddening of the face, but no answer. Charles imploring, explaining his motives. The safety of the boys, care of one in particular, justifying self-revelation. John, chewing on these new demands of him, looks up, looks away, looks awkward. Finally, while surveying the green-leaved ash trees that screen the back of the workhouse, settles on a renewed refusal.
"Best ask the lad himself, Charlie, or one of the boys of the choir."
"Well, I could, but I'm asking you, John. Why can you not suffer my brother's company?"
"Oh, Lord, Charlie,"
shaking his head, looking up at Charles uncomfortably, brows raised.
"For fear, most part. Fear of being hanged for a murderer. I keep from his company, Charlie, to save myself from being hanged for him."
Two men staring at each other, and their eyes are laced with meaning. John looks away first, a sideways glance, then.
"Here, I'll tell you. Find out what they calls him. Ask about the name they kids has for your brother. That'll tell all."
A town about its business on Thursday morning. The domain of housekeepers and good wives of Dorset, broad-skirted and bonnet-topped, supported by the moustache-bearing tradesmen in braces and smart aprons. A proud little centre. The square is smart without being boastful. A broad-fronted bank and two welcoming hotels, but no pompous civil hall, nor other signs of vainglorious, mayoral indulgences. A place of work. Builders, toiling away just off the square in Luke's Lane, and Wilkinson's, the bootmakers, all closed up with a notice in the window citing bereavement. The butcher standing in his doorway, greeting passers-by and customers alike. Charles Ellis, climbing the steps to the school hall, inside a greeting. The tall, pinched frame of Donald Stickland, glasses removed and cleaned while Charles poses his questions, and in answer, a shaking of the head, once, and then again, more emphatically. In the long schoolroom, lit only from one end, Stickland is in darkness and light, casting a spindly shadow halfway down the hall. The dark side of his face is cast into mystery by his presupposing nose. His eyes are content to lurk deep under cavernous brows, looking out with nervous suspicion. He offers a judgment on young Cuff, a difficult child.
Such is the explanation prompting Charles to seek confirmation that Henry Cuff is the subject at hand. Confirmation of understanding. Taught his brothers before him, but they were better disciplined. And then that phrase again. Vain and proud. In need, evidently, of correction. Charles tightening. An imperceptible withdrawal. A dismissive tone. Disbelieving and a little contemptuous. Stickland reciprocating, withdrawing into his schoolroom, further into the shade, like a spider between bricks. Further words exchanged, but only as a means of hardening positions. A handle rattled as a door is opened. An empty-handed retreat. Charles calls upon Samuel. The groom hears relayed conversations with increasing concern. Charles is exasperated.
"They are quite unconscionable. He thinks Henry a mouldering nest of sin. I mean Henry. And I fear my brother may be at the very heart of the boy's torment. He's as bad as Stickland. They both see children as corrupted demons in needing of taming. So now, I'll talk to his parents. There's nowhere else to go."
Late in the afternoon, indeed, the Minster's bell has struck five, and Charles Ellis, walking north along Eastborough, checks his pocket watch. Watch and clock concur. Surprisingly bright for the time of day. Martins curling through the warm afternoon air like fanciful decorations. Warm by the time he reaches Walford Mill. Dabs at his forehead with his handkerchief to clear the sweat away before venturing through the small gate to Mill House. Hand pull for the doorbell. A greeting to the housekeeper, Elizabeth Good. Asking after her family, her sister.
"How's Jane?" "Oh, she's a missing her girls, Charlie. Ended service up Cranbourne, miles away. Please."
A lengthy, cool corridor presided over by a stately, long-case clock that is gently sounding its observations. An emergence into a long, angular drawing room. Windows out onto the lush green gardens. Muttered excuses and Miss Good withdrawing. Outside, well-tended lawns host a flock of starlings. Two weeping willows sweep the surface of the River Allen as it approaches Walford Bridge. Inside, an oak desk, bookshelves fronted with leaden windows, populated by sharply volumes the gentle melodic rhythms of the hallway clock, a fire in the grate that looks to have been burning all morning, and a tall-sided armchair back to the room, facing the garden. A question is lit. Is the armchair occupied? The door's opening, and Elizabeth Good ushering in the lady of the house, Mrs. Cuff. A flurry of skirts, an outstretched hand, and serviceable smile offered for no longer than politeness requires.
"You've met my husband?"
Charles's uncertain frown, a tutting and further rustling of skirts, relocation to the far side of the armchair, and suspicions are confirmed. It is occupied, and has been since Charles entered the room.
"Thomas, a visitor."
"I know,"
comes the self-satisfied answer, spoken by the occupant of the chair. Charles, moving to stand by the window that he might see and be seen, stops himself from looking between man and wife. A clear and discernible age difference. The appearance of the man himself, a pointed nose and lengthy chin, small spectacles, a bald head that is not compensated by uncontrolled eyebrows, rampant nasal hair, and beds of hair flowering in the man's ears.
"Mr. Ellis, isn't it? I knew your father."
A high-pitched voice, collapsing into a squeak in moments of emphasis. An invitation to be seated. An exchange of familiarities. Giles, apologetic. Thomas, condescending. His wife, demure and silent. Charles leading on to the business at hand, an issue raised by Mr. Cuff's niece, shortly to be wed, the welfare of the couple's youngest son. Old man Cuff taking up the topic with earnestness and learned self-confidence, a mini-sermon on the most efficacious methods of child-rearing, the importance of unyielding firmness and consistent application of judicious discipline. Mrs. Cuff enduring the lecture with a straight face, and the same from Charles. the father undermining his own authority by seeking confirmation that Henry is, indeed, their youngest. Charles, offering compliments on the father's wisdom and a sidestep, might some questions be directed to the boy himself? The raising of prodigious eyebrows, surprised by the audacious question. Nonetheless, Mr. and Mrs. Cuff are accommodating, and after the summoning of Elizabeth, the boy is sent for and is soon stood among them. Directed by his aged father to be upstanding, he nonetheless maintains a bearing of dejection, a mother's frowning. Charles' question.
Henry, I have a young nephew who may be coming to live with me. If he does so, I shall have to choose between the schoolroom of Dr. Firth and that of Mr. Strickland. He is a somewhat gentle-mannered, studious boy, not accustomed to rough play or harsh punishment. Which school would best suit him, do you think?
A quick, compulsive answer.
Why, the other one, sir.
A frowning of adults.
The other?
Explanations, justifications, and excuses follow. Mr. Strickland's strictness described. Roughness abounds. Punishments are harsh, exceedingly harsh. A pleading tone not far from distress. Strickland's defender is found in Thomas Cuff.
Misdemeanors are punished in all schools, are they not, boy? A schoolmaster must be strict.
The flickering of eyelids, like a wincing.
They are, sir. But Mr. Strickland is exceedingly strict, sir, sometimes without cause.
And what of that choir, Henry? Should my nephew join?
Oh, no, sir. Do not suffer him to attend the choir. Mr. Ellis, please.
A moment's pause among the elders of the family. Charles lowering the pitch of his voice, softening, consoling.
Why not the choir, Henry? What happens there?
Hesitation and eyes flicking between parents, checking the ice he walks upon, lest he falls through.
Don't send him to the choir, sir.
My brother is the choirmaster, isn't he? What nickname do you boys have for him? Can you tell me?
A widening of eyes, and the answer is clear. To tell would be a fate. Charles sighing, ready to retreat from the ineffable but Cuff senior intercedes.
Come now, answer this, Henry. What's his name?
A moment's panic.
I shall not say it, sir.
Distress edged with tears. But a father's authority has been brought into question.
You would deny me?
No, no, sir.
Charles offers a saving hand.
No doubt you forget.
But the boy's honesty is his undoing.
Why, no, sir. I recall it, but...
But what? Come, come out with it,
Thomas Cuff demands. But Henry remains entrapped by his own morals. Hands behind his back, head lowered so his head of shaggy blonde hair hides his face as he sobs defiantly. He will not speak. Tears drop onto the rug. A mother's compassion overrides and Mrs. Cuff gets to her feet.
Maybe, Henry, Charles splutters, raising a hand to beg indulgence. One last question, Henry. How should my nephew be at Mr. Strickland's and the choir?
The boy's head rising, eyes drowning, cheeks blotchy and flushed.
He should be the most miserable of boys, sir.
Thank you, Henry. You've been very helpful.
The boy withdrawing, the mother ready to guard his retreat, the father open-mouthed, missing his right to dismissal, Charles picking his careful path.
Mr. Cuff, pardon me, please. If you would ask me what manner of man is my brother...
What you say?
My brother, the choirmaster, he is a villain, sir. I would not submit a dog to his care, much less a nephew.
Your nephew is fictional?
A ruse, no more. You'll forgive me, but consider the situation if our roles were reversed. Were you arriving in Wimborne seeking a school for your son, how might you respond to young Henry's opinions?
A deepening frown, considering. Charles appeals to other authorities.
Mrs. Cuff, would you...
Mrs. Cuff's opinion concurs entirely with that of her husband, Cuff snaps.
Of course!
A moment's silence while the gathering gives due consideration. Cuff expresses his reservations.
Dr. Firth is a dandy.
a vain man who will make a virtue of vanity.
Charles momentarily closing his eyes.
There are worse sins, he says with quiet conviction. My brother's flaws are better hidden. I fear they may be far more insidious.
A slow and thoughtful walk home, watching the crows hopping around horse dung cairns in the road.
Charles' office, nestled, cuckoo-like, in the outbuildings behind Westborough. The interior is ordered, but in a manner known only to him. Hurricane lamps burning bright enough to show the thin, sloping marks on 100 slips of paper in dozens of stacks that cover every surface. Charles's nib floating over places and dates, deliveries and consignments. Halifax, Swanage, Oakford Fitzpaine, 3rd, 25th. Ships, wagons, captains and cargoes moving with gentle swaying of the lamplight. Charles, failing to concentrate on his work, his gaze wandering around the room, following thoughts rather than figures. The knock on the door makes him jump, perhaps all the more for it being a timid, uncertain little tapping. One sheet of paper is pulled back to cover another. Chair scrapes over floor. Latch clicks. Door creaks. Light rises upon a familiar face.
Cornelius!
A shadowed expression glancing along the house, reluctant to be witnessed. Charles standing aside to allow entrance. An alarmed, uncertain entry.
I was with Bill, sir. My brother. We were taking a glass of ale with John Street. Said you'd been asking about the choir, Bible, classes, poor Henry Cuff, sir.
Yeah. Sit down, tell me.
Begging your pardon, sir.
More regret, concern on his brow.
Cornelius, I've asked and asked. No one will tell me anything, please.
They do hard by him, sir. Most hard.
Who does? Who are they?
Well,
a nervous glance, checking the reception, his words might receive.
The schoolmaster, Strickland. He was always strict, and he has his way of setting the older boys to punish the younger ones. And the older boys can be dreadful cruel, Mr. Ellis.
He looks up again nervously and licks his lips like a guilty hound.
But your brother, Mr. Ellis, half-brother. He's my half-brother. They have a name for him. Do they not? A nickname.
Nickname, yes. I suppose, yes, they do.
Tell me.
A hint of a frown, as if confused.
They don't call him the choir master, sir. He's the bugger master. Begging your pardon, but that's what they call him. Some find it funny, others not.
Charles, assessing the news.
Bugger master?
He is terrible harsh with the boys, sir. Terrible. He is poor Cuff's principal tormentor.
Silent, Cornelius blinking, Charles frowning.
Bugger master?
A nodding.
Dear God!
And more nodding.
He makes the lad a target for the older boys too. Vicar does nothing, nor the schoolmaster. They all know, though. They know what he is called.
Staring. Eventually, a deep draught of breath. A turning away, momentarily before return.
Very well. Thank you. We'll sort it out. You'll not mention me. No.
No, you can rely on that.
I just had to tell you, Mr. Ellis.
And I'm very glad you did.
Cotton rags for bandages. Knuckles cleansed with witch hazel. Selina the nurse. Charles Ellis the patient.
I thought you were going to kill him,
she says, leaning sideways to stop herself from treading on the cat rubbing against her ankles. Charles, still dark-eyed and white-faced.
I could have.
Charles, don't say such things. It's a mortal sin.
There are worse sins, Selina. Do you know what your brother...
No, and I do not wish to know.
Charles's sudden urgent grip on Selina's wrist.
Selina, you cannot blind yourself.
His urgency, trumped by her thin, stiff determination, wrenching her hand away.
Stop it,
she hisses.
We have lost mother, and we have lost father. All I have left are my brothers. You cannot, you must not betray me with a feud. You might argue, but I will never forgive you, Charles, if you force me to take your side against his. I shall not denounce my brother nor speak ill of him. He is a virtuous man.
Charles, staring at her, nostrils flaring, her hand gently lowering his to the table where she can work on it again, wrapping the cotton over raw knuckles.
You might also think of the impact, Charles, if you seek to destroy your brother's reputation. Think! What should the world say of me if he is disgraced? What have I if I have not my name?
Charles, holding his little sister's hand, staring at flagstones.
He'll not hit you again, he says quieter.
What makes you think?
I know he did, but I've never bested him before. That will give him a shock. He will not dare. Not after that.
He's a man of virtue, Charles.
Yes, Selina. Of course he is.
A bright young morning. Samuel, in his wedding suit, walking towards Charles across Minster Green. A day for a wedding. Blue skies decorated with smart white clouds, and Samuel looking as fine as a pin. He grins at first, but then turns to seriousness and nods back at the Minster.
Is Henry in the choir?
His sisters say he has not been seen since last evening, and it would be great relief for Louisa if she knew where he was. Charles, best man, reliable lieutenant.
I'll ask.
He excuses himself through the gathering guests. Anxiety for Henry largely abated, since he is confident now that Cuff Senior will move him to the other schoolroom. Into the church, cool, dark and quiet. Footsteps on the flagstones echo from the tall arches. The organist frowns, but Charles finds Cornelius Brown among the gathering choristers, eyebrows employed for a beckoning.
We're concerned for Henry Cuff. Is he here yet?
Looking over Cornelius' shoulder, checking the faces.
Thought I saw him earlier, says Cornelius. I look out for him.
Charles returns to the green, catches Samuel's eye. The guests look, in heightened pitch, towards the high street, towards the clattering sound of coaches arriving. Walford Meadows are scented from the grass and decorated with insects and wind-carrion pollen. Over the river itself, dragonflies hover and small clouds of midges drift. If there is something portentous in the air, it cannot be seen, and John Street is insensible to it. He leaves Bill, equally innocent, sorting his boots on the riverbank and wades into the waters of the Allen, humming,
I loved a shepherd girl.
A grip on his string and sickle, swinging his shoulders purposefully. The watching crow is but a bird to him. Queen Victoria, seething with envy at Wimborne's latest bride. Louisa at least thinks it's possible. As she steps from the carriage, awash with white silken lace, an involuntary gasp of admiration escapes from the onlooking crowd. Louisa is taken by her father's hand through the church gates, peering through her veil at grinning faces as though looking out from a painting. She's oil on canvas. Charles ought to be with Samuel, but he wants to finish his errand. Louisa sees him, reaches out a delicate arm with an inquiry on her lips. Charles taking the lightest of grips on her hand.
Cornelius says he saw him in the choir. He's fine.
Oh, thank heavens. Will he sing?
I think not, but he is safe.
Releasing her. Louisa floating from face to face across the green, then passing under the arch through the portico. The light dims and her skin shivers as she passes from the warm summer air outside to the cool of the church. So many faces. Her uncle down from Warminster, her mother seamstress, her many cousins, school friends and companions, her French teacher back from Salisbury, mouthing greetings, advice, good wishes. At the end, stood before the altar, Samuel, grinning broadly, proudly. And when the walk is done, she's standing with him, his presence, her husband. She wants to take his hands, though her father has her arm. A smile at the priest, a hush descending. She looks beyond the priest at the long lines of choir boys. No sign. Louisa draws a deep breath and sighs it out again.
She shall rely on Charles's reassurance, satisfaction, preparedness, her future within easy reach. When John sees the fabric floating among the reeds, he merely thinks it's strange that someone well-to-do should misplace their linen in the river. Even a recognition of the chorister's gown leads him to wonder why a choirboy would not remove his clothes before going for a swim. Then he stops wading, stands still, and takes it all in. The one hand floating, the knuckles breaking the surface, the other arm obscured from view. The sheen on the fabric, from the soaked-in water, and the dreaminess of the boy's gown where it wafts around in an underwater billow. He takes a slow step forwards, frowning, causing breaks in the stream as he does so. The weeds, the gown, and the body move with gentle waves back and forth to acknowledge his approach. He watches the body's open mouth as water drifts in and out like ocean waves among the ribs of a shipwrecked hull. He knows the boy. He recognized the head of curly blonde hair, even though it is spread out, sullied with weed and specks of grain from the mill. John, standing midstream, water pushing against his legs, turns without moving his feet. He is looking back over the fields for someone to help him, someone to absolve him from the scene, to witness his innocence, someone to make it right. But there is no one. He thinks that maybe Bill Brown would be by the bridge, and he even shouts for him.
Bill!
And while Bill calls back, asking what the matter is, John has not the words with which to answer. He looks again at the body, and his eye catches the crow that has been watching him. Black-feathered and cold-eye, the crow seems to sense a threat, lifts its wings and pulls itself into the air. It arcs up and across the field in a great long curl, allowing the wind to take it. John mutters to himself, "Oh, Lord." Charles Ellis, sitting alone in his front room, staring at the empty fireplace where coals have not burned since March. Is he imagining the fire? He is not, although figures ablaze in his fantasies and inflame his emotions. Here flickers the portent on the face of John Street, approaching the wedding party, trailing wet footprints on the flagstones. There the image of old man Cuff, brow crumpled first in confusion and then in disbelief, and Mrs. Cuff, failing in her understanding, and then the crumpling. In the centre, burning brightest, Louisa's face reacting to the words, "Body in the river, Henry." Her hand over her mouth, sisters stepping in beside her, the congregation falling silent, save for two voices that linger, until they too fade in recognition of the inexplicable quiet. In the corner, older recollections, his brother in the library, wiping their asses like a nursemaid. Outside through the window, John once more, his eyes meeting Charles's, and the echo of words spoken over the flowing of the river, slow and wide. "I keep from his company, Charlie, to save myself from being hanged for it." And again, "To save myself from being hanged for it." And the river curls around Walford Meadows, burly and snake-like, onwards deep into the heart of the town. Chapter 2. Crow Court. Wimborne Minster, Dorset, May 1840. "I'll just be 1 minute," the Reverend Giles Cooksley said. He did not look up. Indeed, he maintained his concentration on searching through the Psalms. Searching, as it so happened, for passages that might be consoling in the upcoming remembrance service. He found few that appealed. Most passages caught his eye only because they carried references to judgment. "Behold, he travaileth with iniquity, and hath conceived mischief, and brought forth falsehood. He made a pit, and digged it, and is falled into that ditch which he made." Apposite, one might say. The intent in ignoring the choirmaster was to induce in him some disquiet, although it might have been predicted that a man such as Matthew Ellis would remain uncowed. Annoyingly, rather than waiting meekly in the chair by the desk, he took up a position by the window, clasped his hands behind his back, and looked out over King Street with his feet firmly apart. Giles gave up the charade. He flicked his inkpot closed and could only sigh with petty frustration when a small spot of ink was cast onto the page of his notebook. "So then," he said. The choirmaster grunted a response, but remained motionless. The man was immovable. Was it not an act of hyperphania to fill the room while occupying no more than its edge? "Have a seat. We need to address the matter of Master Cuff." "God rest his soul," Matthew answered as he turned. "Amen." He was a large man, the choirmaster, large with large features. His mottled face was broad and recently bruised around the eye, while his calloused fingers were so thick and powerful, it was a wonder he could hold something so delicate as a sheet of music. Nor did his being seated reduce the imposing effect of his bulk, not least because the wicker chair he occupied was not equal to his proportions. He was in many ways ill-fitted. Nonetheless, he was before the Reverend Giles Cooksley and needed to be addressed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.